you know, ostensibly I'm going to speak about the future of cinema, and I could spout lots of numbers and facts about trends and the growth in the business internationally and so on. I'm not going to do all that because, first of all, I'd have to go look it up online, and you guys can do that too if you want to. I think I'll just tell you a little story about the making of Avatar, because it was a picture that took 4.5 years to make, so it spans a period in the entertainment industry where a lot has changed. And that those changes both affected Avatar, and I think Avatar may, to a certain extent, have affected some of those changes. But to tell you that story, I have to go way back in time to my childhood. And the moment that I became a lover of cinema, and really what it was is that I was fascinated by a magic that I could not understand, that I could not explain. And I can think of some very distinct examples of this. The Ray Harryhausen films, the stop-motion animated films, Seventh Voyage of Sinbad, Jason and the Argonauts, where the skeletons come up out of the ground, and Mysterious Island. These were films that, to the eye, could not be explained. They were pure magic. And the science fiction writer Arthur C. Clarke's third law states that any sufficiently advanced technology is indistinguishable from magic. And I thought, I don't know how this was done, and I don't care, but I'm a fan for life. And of course, I love science fiction and fantasy. And later, as I became a filmmaker, I worked in that genre. My first film was The Terminator, then I did Aliens. And I became a practitioner of that technique of visual effects, which was the sufficiently advanced technology that becomes indistinguishable from magic. And I loved that part of it. And an interesting thing happened on my third film, The Abyss, where, and Arun mentioned it, the water tentacle, which we called the pseudopod. I needed a very practical solution to a script problem, how to create this. And in the course of solving that problem, we wound up using CGI, as we called it at the time, computer-generated imagery. And I was completely inexperienced with that. And I have to remind everyone, this was only 22 years ago. And so much has changed in the two decades since, because now CG is very common and is used in most movies to some extent or another. But at the time, it was very exotic. And with The Abyss, we used the CG to create this soft surface character, and it was the first time that a soft surface character with facial expressions ever appeared in a feature motion picture. And I remember, even though the film didn't do well, it barely broke even, I remember the effect that this had on the audience. And it was really transformative, because people were seeing something that was magical. They were seeing something that was as if in a dream, phantasmagorical, something surreal that looked real but couldn't possibly be real. And I really realized the power of CG to inspire the imagination of the audience. So I used it again quickly in Terminator 2. That was in 1991 for the Liquid Metal Man, which Arun mentioned. And of course, that film was wildly successful beyond our expectations. And I really realized that we were onto something, that this idea of the technology which can create magic in the mind of the audience is something that I needed to pursue. So I started a company called Digital Domain, and the purpose of that company was to pursue this idea of CG, to raise the art and the technology of computer animation and computer-generated imagery. So I worked in that company for a couple of years, and about 1995, I started to realize that I needed to challenge my guys at that company. I needed to throw down the gauntlet and say, let's not just build iteratively as the other companies are doing. Let's go beyond. Let's go one or two quantum steps beyond. So I wrote a story called Avatar, or Avatar, that was just chock full of creatures, characters, and phantasmagorical settings, floating mountains, and these tall blue people with the big golden eyes. And I knew at the time that we would create them using CG, but that it would be an actor-driven process. I'm going to talk a little bit more about that in a second. But what happened was, as we broke it down and we looked at the plausibility of making this film at the time, we realized that it just wasn't possible, that we would need to wait a few years because the tide was slowly rising on CG. Many other filmmakers were pushing the technique forward, and I knew that eventually the industry would come up to a capability that might make it possible to make this movie. But I had gone too many quantum steps beyond what was possible at the time. So I made another little movie about a ship that sinks, and that took a couple of years. And in the wake of that film, I thought, let's do something really challenging. So I decided to commit myself to making documentary films, which turned, you know, I think when we're making theatrical feature films, we sort of have an idea that documentary films aren't, they're kind of a second-class citizen. I found that they're very, very difficult, and they required just as much discipline. And we were doing deep ocean exploration for those films. But another thing that fascinated me is that in 1995, same year that I wrote Avatar, I also made a 3D film, and it was for a theme park attraction because there were no 3D theaters at that time. And the cameras were enormous. They were the size of refrigerators. And it was very, very difficult to shoot, but I actually really enjoyed the process. So in around 2000, I started to work with a technology partner named Vince Pace to build smaller-scaled, more manageable digital cameras based on HD technology that could shoot 3D. I was fascinated by the idea of 3D, and I wanted to shoot with these cameras, and we could only show them in IMAX. That was the only way that you could show a 3D movie at that time. So we used the 3D cameras to make the documentary films over the next few years. And after the first few weeks of working with these cameras, I made a firm decision for myself that I would never go back to 2D again. I would never go back to film, and I would never go back to 2D. I was going to be digital all the way. I was going to be 3D all the way. And my reasons for that were that I felt that looking at the image on the screen that was coming from these cameras wasn't like watching a film. It was like looking through a window into a reality. And if I could get that kind of power into my fictional filmmaking, I believed I could do something much more extraordinary than anything I had done in the past. The only problem was there were no theaters. There were no theaters to show such a movie if we were to make one at that time. So I thought, I'll continue to work in the documentaries. Meanwhile, I'll get out and I'll evangelize to the exhibition community, to the theater owners, that they need to adopt this new technology. Because the digital projection technology that was just becoming available at that time was capable of supporting 3D. And my vision for what was going to happen was that there would be a digital cinema revolution, and that digital cinema would become the way we watch movies. And there were a lot of good economic reasons for that, because we spend a lot of money on release prints, and we spend, let's say, $1,500 for a photochemical release print, as opposed to $100 for a digital print. So we could slash these costs, which are maybe $1 billion worth of money spent on prints a year, we could slash it to a fraction of that. So the economics made sense. The problem was nobody wanted to move forward. They argued for years about standards and security and encryption and who was going to pay for it, who would benefit from it. So my vision that 3D would kind of ride in on the back of digital cinema wasn't happening. It wasn't happening in any meaningful forward progression. So I kept going out and telling the exhibitors, look, guys, we can do something amazing here. Finally, I took the bull by the horns, and I got a couple of other filmmakers who had either made 3D films or who wanted to. And those were Bob Zemeckis and George Lucas, who wanted to convert his Star Wars films to 3D, Robert Rodriguez, and Peter Jackson, and myself. And we went and got up on a stage at Show West, which is a huge conclave of exhibitors, theater owners. And we stood there and we said, this revolution is happening. And that was in early 2005. And I actually think they listened, or they started to listen, because that year things started to change and more theaters started to get converted into digital cinema and so on. But it wasn't changing fast enough for me. I wanted thousands of these screens all over the world. So I thought, you know what? I'm just going to have to make a movie, and it's got to be a big movie, and it's got to be exciting, and like the films that I've made in the past, science fiction, fantasy, something amazing, and we'll shoot it in 3D, and then they can't ignore it, because if they want this film, they want to book it in 3D, and they want to be competitive, they're going to have to put it in the screens. So I looked at all the various films that I had, and I remembered Avatar, which I hadn't thought of for 10 years. And I read the script, thought it was pretty good. So we actually started Avatar in May of 2005. And the first 2 years of working on Avatar consisted of two things, which were being developed in parallel. I had a team of artists, some of the best sketch artists in the world, creating creatures and plants and floating mountains and the Na'vi people, all the different characters. So there was the art team who were creating what everything would look like. And I had another team, and their job was to create the method by which we would create this world. And we developed a bunch of new technology, and again, this took 2 years to do. And I knew that the film would succeed or fail based on this, based on a tight close-up of these CG characters. Because if they didn't have the heart and the soul of a real person, even though they were CG, the film would have been a waste of time and money. And we looked at what was available at the time in terms of performance capture, and we decided to do it with performance capture. And the thing you have to remember about performance capture is it's not photography. There's no camera. It's done by capturing what the actor does, how the actor performs the scene. And there can be many actors in the scene, however many there would be in the final scene as you see it. But the camera work and the lighting and all that are all done separately and later. The actors don't have to be there for it. So it's a very interesting process from a director's standpoint. And we knew that it had already been done, but it hadn't been done up to a standard where I believed the emotion of the character, where I believed that the heart and soul of the actor was truly there in the final character. So we created a new method, and it's called image-based facial performance capture. And the way we do it is we put a helmet on the actor's head, very thin, very small, and it has a little boom that comes out, kind of like a concert microphone. And on that boom is a camera, very small, standard definition video camera. And it shoots the actor's face, so no matter what they're doing, if they're running, jumping, turning, fighting, whatever they're doing, it's capturing a locked-off, tight close-up of the actor's face. And it sees how their lips move, their teeth, how their tongue interacts and forms speech, sees the eye movement. All of this data gets streamed into the computer model of the character and brings that model to life. Now, we capture the body in the normal, traditional manner of motion capture with the suits with the markers all over it. And I'm sure most people have seen that clips on TV. That wasn't the revolutionary part. The facial part was the revolutionary part. And I was a little concerned that maybe when the actors showed up that they wouldn't want to act with a helmet on their head and a little camera sitting out in front of their face. And it's a legitimate concern. I'm sure you're thinking, I'd never do that. I found out something very interesting. After the first few sessions, after the first few weeks of capture, the actors seemed to really love it. And at first I thought they were just sort of being polite to me and were very enthusiastic about the film. But it turns out that they really loved it. And the actors that worked doing the performance capture characters in Avatar, they worked on the film for over a year, some of them, and they never lost that interest, that love of the process, and I figured out why. And it's because of the difference between performance capture acting and acting for a camera. When you act for a camera, you do the scene multiple times. You'll do a wide shot, and then you'll do some closer coverage. Maybe you'll shoot over the shoulder to one actor and then turn around. And turning around is kind of a big deal. You have to turn all the lighting around and move the cameras. It takes hours and hours to do. And every single time you move that camera to a new position, the actor has to reproduce their performance again and again. And if there's a moment where you have to cry in a scene or laugh at a joke in a scene or whatever it is, or look into the leading lady's eyes with love, you have to do that over and over and over. With performance capture, you do it once. At least you do it once to your satisfaction, and then all the camera coverage is done later. So I found out that the actors loved it because it was a pure form of acting. And it was a pure form of directing for me because I wasn't concerned with all that stuff. I didn't care about the lighting and what the extras were doing in the background, and you know, if a car was driving by at the wrong time or whatever it might be, I was just there for them. And that's why I believe they really enjoyed this process, and that's why I believe their performances are so good. And then I had to task the visual effects team after the fact to make sure that those performances arrived in the final character, in the avatar characters, with no loss whatsoever, no loss to the emotionality. And we got all that working, and we made a lot of mistakes. It was a long process. It was an exploratory process, very much like a research project. We made mistakes. We learned from it. It was probably the most stimulating and interesting moment of my career, because here I was, I'd been a director for 25 years. And as you know, a director has to always have the answers. Even if you don't really have the answer, you have to have the answer. And here was a situation where we were encountering so many new things that I would say, you know, guys, I don't know what to do next. What do we do here? And sometimes my little team of investigators wouldn't know the answer either. So we'd stop in the middle of a shooting day, pull up a table, sit down, and talk about it until we figured out what to do next. And I thought, this is the coolest thing to be doing, because we are so far on the frontier that we can't go to a book and look it up. We can't go to a manual. There's nobody to call. We had to figure it out ourselves. And we loved that. And the cast felt that. They felt that they were part of something new and exciting. And there were some bells and whistles that are really interesting. We had a thing called the virtual camera. And when I say all the camera stuff was done later, I still had to have a sense of what that would look like. So I had my virtual camera, and I could look through it. And you have to imagine, when we're capturing this, it's an empty stage. It's like this gray floor here. There's no set there. There's no jungle. When I looked through the virtual camera, I could see Zoe Saldana or Sam Worthington as if they were in the jungle of Pandora as their 10-foot-tall blue characters with their long tails and their big golden eyes. That's what I saw through my camera. It was like a window into another world. And that was my primary tool working as a director. And I would use that as a kind of director's viewfinder to block the scene. Then I'd set it aside and forget it, and we'd focus on the acting. And I'd go back later, and I'd create all the shots. So we worked our way through this whole capture process, and then we had to shoot the live action. Because the film is both. It has both a CG portion and a live action portion. For the live action portion, we used the 3D camera systems that Vince Pace and I had developed for the documentary films, but we had been improving them steadily over a period of years. It was a 7-year development process. And by this point, we called it the Fusion Camera System, and it was a cinema-grade camera. It was there for the sole purpose of making 3D movies. And we were very proud of this camera. Of course, it broke down, and it was glitchy and all those sorts of things, but that was part of the fun. Again, we were pioneering. So we shot the live-action portion. Took about 4 months. And we really sort of figured out the ground rules for how to shoot good 3D so that it would all cut together and flow nicely. So we finished that, and then we went into the post-production process. Now imagine this. We're spending on the order of $250 million, and we're 3 years into a 4.5-year film before we see one shot that actually proves that what we've set in motion is going to work. And when we finally got that shot, and it was a close-up of our girl, Neytiri, and she's looking at Jake, and I don't know if anybody's seen the movie, she's about to shoot him with her bow, and she decides not to, and you see that decision play out in her eyes. She was alive. She looked real. And we just sat there. We've completed that little scene. It was 6 or 7 shots. And we just sat and watched the scene over and over again because we realized this was going to work. Mm. We just had one little problem. We had to do the other 2,600 shots in which those characters appeared. Somehow managed to do that all the next 18 months. And interestingly, the way it works is that it all gets crowded, like with every process, it all gets crowded into the last few weeks. And I think we finished something like 1,200 shots in the last 5 weeks before we had to deliver the movie. The interesting thing was, that wasn't our biggest problem. Our biggest problem was marketing the picture, because we didn't have big movie stars in the film. We didn't have Tom Cruise, Brad Pitt, or yourself. We had a cast of relative unknowns, except for Sigourney Weaver, but she was in a supporting role. And we had no brand awareness of any kind. It wasn't, you know, the sixth Harry Potter film or the fourth Spider-Man film or the third Mission Impossible film. You know, but yet we were making a piece of entertainment that had to play at a global level, had to be successful internationally, and we had no brand awareness. So how do we create that? So again, the first thing we did was we went to the exhibitors. So we went to Amsterdam, to Cine Expo, and we showed them 25 minutes of the film in 3D. Some of it live action, some of it CG, mostly CG. We took them into the Pandoran rainforest, and especially the night portion of it where everything's glowing was very dreamlike. And we got rave reviews from the exhibitors and from collected press. And we got the exhibitors on our side. They started to get ready, you know, to put in more screens to be ready for the film. They had enough time to do that. So it really started to build a wave of buzz. And then that wave of buzz continued through Comic-Con. And then we did something kind of extraordinary. Every time we had showed 20 minutes or so of the movie to friends or to a selected group of people, we got such a powerful feedback from them that they really wanted to see the rest. They wanted to see what happened next. So I thought, why not do that? Why not let the public see 15 minutes of the film? So we thought, how to do this? So in August, we took 150 IMAX theaters around the world in 40 countries, and we invited people to come for free and watch our movie, 15 minutes of it. That's unprecedented. That had never been done before, and we didn't know if it was going to blow up in our face or if it was going to work. But what I was afraid of with Avatar was the 30-second TV spot. I thought there was such a potential for these blue faces to not work when you just see them in a moment. You could quickly judge them as maybe animation or just something strange that doesn't make sense. And we knew that it worked within the context of the film. So this Avatar Day experiment, that's what we called it, Avatar Day, this global experiment actually worked very well, because what happened was the same day we released a teaser trailer, and the teaser trailer bombed. We got a lot of negative feedback from that. And if we hadn't done the other thing, we'd have been sunk. So, but what happened was it started controversy. The people that saw it in a movie theater said, no, this is a fantastic experience. And the people that saw it online said, nah, it looks, you know, they look like Smurfs. So I thought, well, controversy is good, because at least people are talking about it. And that's actually how we started a sort of viral marketing campaign that worked on a global level to raise awareness about the movie. And then, of course, we followed up with good promotional partners. We had Coke Zero, LG, McDonald's, and Panasonic, who did a combined, I think, $100 million in promotional awareness value to get it out there. Because this type of picture, everybody's got to know about it before it opens. Now, I'd say we were 70% successful in all of that. When the picture opened, it opened on December 18th. It did pretty well. Wasn't a record weekend by any stretch of the imagination. We did about $75 million, which, you know, you compare that to Alice in Wonderland, which just did $115 million. So, you know, pretty good, not a record. But I wasn't that concerned about it, because I believe that if we could just get the picture out there to enough people, it would start to work its magic, that the 3D would bring them in, that the world of Pandora would work on them, and that's exactly what happened. So we started to actually build momentum. We actually went up in some markets. And this is where I really became aware of how much things had changed with the 3D. We had markets that had never been significant markets before suddenly doing enormous amounts of business. Russia had 320 3D screens. We made $100 million in Russia. No one had ever made any money in Russia before. China, we made $200 million in China on 600 3D screens. Now, there were a bunch of 2D screens as well, but what we saw was a pattern where we were making 80%, 75, 80% of our revenue in some of these territories from the 3D screens as opposed to the 2D screens. And we saw that in France, where we made $150 million on 520 screens, and the UK and Japan, that we saw that, and other emerging markets like Vietnam. We saw this pattern worldwide. So I really believe that the 3D is a significant part of the success of Avatar. So now what happens next is we get a big stampede. And now everybody thinks 3D is the killer app. So Hollywood starts to stampede toward this. But of course, they do it the wrong way. They start to try to take movies that they've already made in 2D and quickly switch them into 3D, which you can't do. You know, and you know they're going to try to do it in 8 weeks. Now, I believe firmly that you shoot in 3D. You get the 3D cameras and you shoot in 3D if you want the film to be in 3D. So, but you know, we'll see how this plays out. At least there's a lot of enthusiasm, and now we've got a big log jam at the theaters. We don't have enough theaters again because now there's too many 3D films. So now the theater owners have to step up yet again to a second wave. We have another interesting phenomenon, which is the consumer electronics companies are releasing 3D screens to the home. So you've got Samsung and Panasonic and LG and Sony all making big 40, 50, 60 inch plasma and LED screens that can show 3D. Well, that's great, except there's nothing to show on them. If you take all the 3D movies together and show them back to back in a marathon session, you'll have 25 hours of programming. What are you gonna do for the rest of your life with that spanking new 3D screen? So they've managed to create, I think, something very interesting, which is a content gap. It's exactly the opposite of what we had in theaters. In theaters, we had more movies than we had screens for. Now we're going to have these 4, 5, 6 million TV sets shipped this year that can show 3D and not enough stuff to run on them. So what'll happen, I predict, is that the networks and satellite and cable companies will jump in and they'll start figuring out ways to deliver 3D to the home. And there's a very simple way to do it. Basically, anybody that can carry an HD signal to the home can send a 3D signal to one of these sets and it'll decode it. So this is going to happen very fast. There's a lot of stuff that has to happen, a lot of funding models that have to be put in place, and we've got to take our existing stereoscopic or 3D camera infrastructure from the sort of 50 cameras that exist right now up to thousands of cameras to be able to shoot sporting events and live entertainment, music, concerts, scripted entertainment for television. But this is all going to be coming at you pretty fast. Now, what I can't predict is what effect that will have on the movie-going experience. Because I think one of the most fascinating things that came out of Avatar and some of the other 3D films is that people are going back to the cinema all over the world after years of this kind of passionate, affair with getting smaller and smaller, showing your films on smaller and smaller devices, laptops and even, iPhones, because you want the immediacy, you want the quick access, and people are willing to look at bootlegs and download, bootleg downloads, pirated video, all this stuff. People have said, enough. The pendulum is swinging the other direction. They want to go back to that big, immersive, widescreen experience with a room full of people. There's something about the vibe of being in an audience and sharing something with an audience, something that's up on the screen that's mesmerizing and hypnotic. They want that experience again. I'm not saying that one is going to replace the other. I think that people are now saying, I can choose between these two different experiences, and I understand the difference. And maybe I do want it quick so that Monday morning I know what this movie's all about. Or maybe, 6 weeks into the run, I'm going to wait in line to go see it in IMAX 3D. We're seeing both of those things happening simultaneously. Because interestingly enough, even though Avatar is the highest grossing film in history, it's also the most pirated film in history. But the pirating hasn't really hurt the box office. So people are making this clear distinction. And I think that's really wonderful because it's kind of reinstating cinema back to the stature that it should have always had. One last subject. 3D is not the main reason for the success of Avatar, I believe. I believe that Avatar works because it's a story that works, because it's characters that work, that are performed by really, really talented actors who did amazing performances and have touched the hearts of people around the world. And because of all those artists who designed that world of Pandora did such a beautiful job in bringing those creatures to life. And you know, it's the emotions of the film. It's also the themes of the film. People are responding to the themes. Dare I say, even the spirituality of the film. And I've got so much feedback from all over the world of people whose hearts were touched by the movie. None of that has anything to do with 3D. None of that has anything to do with the technology. That's good old-fashioned storytelling, good old-fashioned acting, and having something to say. And I believe, since it's such a personal film for me, based on all my feelings when I was a teenager about how we treat our planet and the nature of war. You know, when I was a teenager in the 60s, we were in the Vietnam War, and it was the start of the environmental movement. These are themes that I've had throughout my life. I wasn't making a movie that was just responding to a trend from the previous season of successful films. I was telling a story from the heart. And I think all films, no matter what the scale, from the smallest independent to the biggest film, should be a personal film. That's how I think films should be made. And we need to speak as artists. We need to speak with our own personal passion, not what we think the audience wants, but what we would want to see up on the screen. And along in that same vein, you know, the environmental theme of the film has touched people around the world. And I have no real illusions about the power of an entertainment movie to really change things. But I do think that what we've found from the feedback coming back to us is that Avatar is affecting people around the world. And so, you know, I feel that I almost have not only an opportunity but a duty to follow up with that and try to have Avatar be as helpful and constructive as it can be in terms of raising consciousness about the changes that we have to make in our society to protect our mother planet. And you know, we've gotten groups from the Amazon, from Ecuador and Peru, and from right here in India, in Orissa State, where indigenous tribal people are being displaced by mining interests and so on. And it's happening all around the world. And we get these calls and emails and letters flooding in from people who say, that's my reality. That's really happening. And it's interesting to see how this film is being seen through the lens of different people's reality around the planet. And it's really exciting for me to see the power that a film truly can have. And so I would just conclude by saying that technology, if you think of it like a wave, it's a wave that as a filmmaker you can surf it. When you surf that wave, you'll pick up tremendous speed and power. And if you don't, it's going to break over you, crash down on your head, and leave you behind. But the technology is not the most important thing. It's the story, it's the characters, it's the heart and soul of the movie that's the most important thing. And I would say movies are made from the heart. They're not made by computers. And I'll just end by saying, Namasatnak Lortak Sivai, which in Navi means may the Great Mother smile on us all. Thank you. Now we can talk.
Thank you. Thank you, James. I mean, that's an amazing story of determination, imagination, perseverance, risk, everything. And I'm so glad it worked out for you.
It worked out.
I wouldn't want to think otherwise. Let me just open this conversation with Aamir. About something which you have in common between you two is that you actually have made films with a message. Sam Goldwyn said, the great filmmaker, you know, you want to send a message, use Western Union. And the studios, I know your studios were in fact wanting you to take out this tree-hugging stuff out of your movie. How important is a message in a film for you when you make a film? And actually, Aamir is the only man on the planet who hasn't seen Avatar. but he's going to soon.
he's been busy.
Yeah. Well, let me start by saying that it was really amazing listening to you, James. And I can really understand what you've been through with, you know, every week and every month and every day of the progress that you made on the film. And the first time that you saw the footage, actually, I could really imagine that. And as a film person, I could really understand what you and your team must have gone through. So congratulations, and you know, for the wonderful effort that you did. And it is really an honor and a privilege to share the stage with you. And I was very keen to come to listen to you, actually. So throughout this talk, I'm going to listen more than I speak, hopefully. I would actually agree with James on a couple of things. I think that what you said is very true, that you know, technology is something that is another tool which you can use to tell a story better, but at the heart of it, it is a story, and that is what I've always believed. In fact, interestingly, I had always imagined that when I make my first film as a director, there were two areas that I felt I was really weak in. I needed to understand better before I embark on making a film. And one of them was sound. I felt I needed to understand sound better and how I can use it as a tool. And the other thing that I really felt I needed to learn about is special effects and visual effects. It's something that is totally alien to me as a film person here in India. And what is unfortunate, and as I hear you speak, I get so excited, you know, because I think in Hollywood, there is so much of joy and effort that has gone into research and development. You know, I've read about George Lucas doing that when he was doing Star Wars, and now, you know, you guys did this with Avatar, and it's so exciting to hear that, you know, and I felt that that's one thing that we really, lack in as a film industry. We don't invest at all in research and development over here in India, and I feel really sad about that. And so before I would have made my first film, I mean, in my head I thought that before I make my first film, and before I even decide what to make, I want to learn, I probably want to come to LA, and I still want to do that, by the way. So I'm going to come to your studio and hopefully ask you to show me the rushes that you shot with to understand the process of how you shot and how it finally, you know, from the start to the end. As it turned out, I ended up directing a film by accident. So I couldn't...
All films are directed by accident.
Yeah. So it was a film I was not meant to direct, but eventually I did. And so my plans of learning as a film person in these two areas is yet to come, you know, it has yet to actually happen. So that's one thing I really want to pick up on. And I think that in India, research and development is really something we need to work on, and something that I think it just needs a lot of courage, because you need to believe in what you have in mind and then go after it. Something that we need to work on. Arun, responding to your specific question of message. Well, I believe that cinema, the core responsibility of cinema is to entertain. But I also believe that you can't really entertain unless you're telling me something, unless you're engaging me in some way. So I don't know whether I can say message, but there has to be something that I'm communicating through my film. And it's what we call, you know, the central theme of the film. Or I remember when I, as a kid, my father was a filmmaker as well, and so was my uncle. And as a kid, when I used to love to listen to stories. So I used to come back from school, and there'd be, you know, my dad listening to a script. Writers have come home pitching ideas, and I'd sit in the corner and listen to them talk, and I'd get fascinated by, you know, all the stories that I listened to. And at the end of it all, my dad would always ask him, so what is your story in one line? What is the message of your film? What are you trying to say? So the writer would have to think of what his story was in one line. That's one thing I heard him repeat every time he listened to a story.
Absolutely.
So I think that ultimately, I mean, cinema is a very young art form. It is one of the youngest art forms, and essentially we're telling stories. And we have so many tools now to tell the story. And in that story, if there is something that is of value that we are conveying, then that it becomes that much more interesting for an audience to receive. Of course, we have to convey it in an interesting manner, in a manner which engages them, a manner which enriches them, perhaps. So that's what I feel. I feel that, you know, I feel that you should have a message. I mean, I'm not saying you need to start a college or something when you're making a film, but it's great to convey something, and I think that's what people receive when they're listening to, or watching a film or listening to a story. Even if it's something as simple as, you know, if it's a film about the triumph of the human spirit, like Lagan was, it's not a great message. It's not a message which, like Tare Zameen Par, which is about childcare and education, but it's still a message which is telling you something positive, which is giving you something, which is inspiring you, which is giving you courage, perhaps, which is giving you hope, you know. So even if the message is simple, I think that you need a message, is what I feel.
James said another thing, which is that he makes movies for himself.
Everything he said is so brilliant.
You agree with it's right on the money.
You said something that you make films for yourself, what you would like, and you don't have an audience in mind. Right. Is that the same for you? I mean, do you make a film for yourself, or do you have an audience in mind? I mean, for example, you thought you were making an action film with Avatar, and it ended up being a very emotional story where women have connected with it, and it's become a transgender kind of film. So do you have an audience in mind when you make a film, or you say you make a film which you like?
Well, I think when I read a script or when I'm listening to a script, I'm the audience at that time. And as an audience, if it engages me, excites me, you know, then I want to be part of it. And at that time, when I come out of the script and I'm like, wow, that is great. For example, Tare Zameen Par, I just loved it. I was crying buckets when I was listening to the script. And in fact, you know, 15 minutes into the film, into this narration, I had to get up and, you know, I had to stop Amol, who was narrating it to me. And I said, just 1 second, I had to go to the loo, get a towel, come back and sit down and say, yeah, now continue. Because I was just weeping away right through it. So once that emotional journey was over for me, and I said, listen, we have to make this film. Then you sit down and think of the practical side of it, and you're like, okay, so this is really unusual for mainstream cinema. It's about childcare and education, and probably the market is not going to look very kindly onto this, but we have to do this. And so let's find a way of how to make it practically possible. You know, so I think for most filmmakers, James, I would imagine that's, at least for me, it is, I never sit back and think, what should I do which will excite the audience? Or is this a script that's going to excite the audience? I never think of that. I just think of whether it excites me and that's it, you know.
If I'm writing and I can't make myself cry when I'm writing, you know, the big scene or you know, whatever scene is supposed to have an emotional reaction, then I don't believe it. I know I haven't arrived, you know.
Right.
And for me, it's not about pleasing a hypothetical audience based on what worked last year or what the last successful film was. It's pleasing the audience that I carry around in the back of my mind with me all the time, that really consists of a bunch of clones of me, you know, because my taste is very kind of blue collar. I didn't go to film school. I didn't study film aesthetics. I mean, I've absorbed a lot along the way out of respect for film and film history, but I don't look at things that way. It's not, for me, I'm not referencing other movies. And I know some filmmakers really spend a lot of time referencing other movies when they're making films. I think it's an unhealthy practice. Sometimes it works for them.
I agree.
Sometimes it doesn't. But, you know, I think you have to live life directly and then have something to say based on what you've lived and what you've experienced, the relationships that you've had, the defeats that you've had, the heartbreaks that you've had. All have to feed into your film.
Yeah.
But also, for me, the movies that I saw, you know, kind of in my formative years, are that fan that sat there enthralled in the movie theater, that fan is still back there in the back of a little movie theater in my head. You know, and if I can't run that movie on the screen, kind of my imagination, when I'm writing or when I'm reading a script before the fact, then I don't feel it. I don't feel the project has validity, you know. And I think that's what you're saying when you say that you have to have an emotional reaction to it when when you read it.
You know, I really wanted to say this again. Yeah, I mean, I get so excited when I hear what you guys went through and what you did. It's really fascinating. I mean, I don't know how many people here would appreciate what James has been through, because to actually, you know, do research and development and Are you an engineer, or do you come from a science background, or what?
Well, I studied physics. I was a machinist. I love engineering. I used to build racing engines for my friends.
Right.
I was a hot rodder gearhead, you know. So I know my way around machinery, but I don't have a degree. I'm practicing engineering without a degree.
Well, in terms of story, in terms of stories, and you know, whether we look at audiences, I know a lot of the filmmakers who do actually over here in India who kind of feel or like to know, feel that they can predict what. I can never do that. I can never predict what an audience will like. So I only know what I like.
Oops.
I only know what I like. I never know what an audience would like. So I don't want to second guess, and I don't want to try and predict whether the audience is going to like it. I just like what I'm doing, and then I hope that the audience also likes it, you know.
Do you find it hard to stay fresh in the editing process for your movie when you've seen it over and over again, so that you continue to be open to the film emotionally?
Well, you know, I've just directed one film so far, and I have to say that I was, in fact, I did feel fresh as I was cutting the film right through. And something that I've been doing for the last 20 years as an actor, in most of the films that I've been associated with as an actor, is we test the film with an audience. Mm. And I find that that has really been so helpful, because when you're making a film, you're so close to it that often you are not aware how, you know how you're communicating, but you don't know how it's being received. Mm-hmm. So the test screenings really help us understand how a film is being received.
Right.
And then it helps you to perhaps alter things if you need to.
I think there's a vibe in the room when you test screen a movie, even if it's not a comedy where there's a lot of laughter or a lot of outward emotion, I think you can feel the audience. Mm. In fact, I think there's something just about sitting in a room with an audience about to watch your movie. Mm. When I sit there with an audience and I think of my movie, I already start to hate parts of it based on what I think they're not going to like.
Right.
You know, right. It's just a different experience when you're in a room with a bunch of people and you have to show it to them.
Why did you ask me, do I feel fresh even as in the editing process?
Well, as a producer, even you live with your cuts of your film. I just found on Avatar, especially because it was such a long project, that it was so hard to try to stay new to the film. Mm. So many decisions had been made so far ahead of time, and we did an interesting trick where, because I believe that editors cut too fast these days. I'm like, in action, they cut fast and people get disoriented.
Yeah.
And and because you learn your own film so well from looking at it, we did a thing where we put the film backwards and watched it mirror image.
Uh-huh.
Watched the whole film mirror image. It was like watching it for the first time.
Wow.
And if you've learned your movie too much, too well, you know where the next thing is going to happen, even before the shot is cut, before you cut to the shot.
Right.
You know that the guy's going to come through the door over on the right side of the screen.
He comes on the
so you're already looking there. Whoa, no, he's over there.
Yeah.
So after a while, you just sort of give up and watch it
fresh.
Fresh,
well,
yeah.
That's a great, neat idea. I should try that idea.
It only works a couple times. But
Yeah, that's interesting.
What do you think is the difference, besides the technical aspects which you talked about, research, the difference between the way Hollywood works and the way Bollywood works?
Well, I'm not quite sure how Hollywood works because I haven't worked there ever, but I would imagine that in
we
essence...
We can fix that.
Sorry?
We can fix that.
But I would imagine in a sense it would probably be quite similar. In a sense, I guess it would be similar. I mean, I think in terms of technology, Hollywood is far ahead of
do you have agents?
Well, kind of. They're not really, not in as organized way.
Do you have leading
ladies? I don't have an agent, for example.
Do you have a leading lady that won't come out of her trailer because she's concerned about a mole
or a zit
on her face?
Yeah.
Because you have those things, it's the same.
Yeah. Well, I've read, you know, a lot of books on lives of personalities from Hollywood, and judging by that, I think it's pretty similar, I think.
What about the role of studios? I mean, the studios are a big thing in America. I mean, with money like that riding on a film, They want to interfere.
Well, you know, they do, and you know, the guys that that made Avatar, I'd worked with before on Titanic,
and I looked at them. And you had trained them by then.
I looked at them as part. What's that?
I said you've trained them by then.
Oh yeah. They were already beaten. It didn't stop them from having lots of good ideas for how I could cut the movie. But they trusted me, you know, because we'd been through it before, and I saw them as partners, not as the guys that I had to fight, mm-hmm. you know, but guys that I had to, you know, I found myself in an interesting position on Avatar where you know, leadership as a director and a producer, you know, and as the head of a major media empire, you know how leadership is kind of a top-down process, and you lead by example, and you manage a certain way. I found in dealing with the studio that I had to manage up as well. I had to if I didn't show them the confidence that we knew what we were doing,
right.
And when we were having problems and we had made mistakes and it was costing money and affecting the schedule, I had to go to them and show leadership in the sense of, all right, here's what we did wrong, we've solved the problem, we know how to fix it, you're going to see a change in 3 weeks, watch that, and you'll have a way to measure that we're going to fix this. And we were in unknown, uncharted territory.
Sure.
You know, and before the meeting, but I would go in, and if I was calm, they would be calm. So I found that it really worked in both directions. So I was dealing with my partners, you know, I wasn't dealing with irrational bosses,
sure.
You know. I mean, there's plenty of caricatures of the studio guys.
Yeah, I think a lot of that confidence also comes from the fact that if they know that they can trust you with your intentions.
Right.
So I think a lot of it comes from there, because if a person who's backing you financially or a studio is backing you and they trust the fact that you are as concerned, I mean not as, actually you're more concerned about the film, and you are a practical person, then I think they are willing to go that extra mile with you.
Yeah.
You know, if they know that your intentions are in the right place.
Well, it's trust.
Yeah, it's trust.
Aren't we talking about trust? And trust only comes from relationships that have some standing, that have some time behind
them. You didn't
them.
See any sense of nervousness about
absolutely.
Where this taking so long and spending so much money, that they were not
one,
getting...
One clue is the puddle of urine that they were standing in.
But you had a rough time with Titanic. I mean...
Titanic was much tougher
because
than Avatar. Titanic was a nightmare because the studio didn't trust us as much at that time, and they had laid off half the risk to another studio. So we had Fox and Paramount, and they were mostly in a war with each other to try to make each other look bad in the press, and it made the whole project just look like this huge mess, this huge fiasco.
Right.
And really, we just kept our heads down while the rockets went overhead. And just kept working on the movie, praying that it would be good. Yeah. But up until it was released, and even a few weeks after it was released, we just assumed that we were not going to make any money at all. Because the film didn't even really open that big. It opened to $28 million, which, you know, for a U.S. domestic opening of a big movie, that's a failure.
Yeah,
you know.
Yeah.
But then it just went up.
Went up.
You know. But again, we didn't know until weeks into it that we even had something. And we were just satisfied to be making, you know, a film that we believed in. I mean, ultimately, I think that's the most important thing. If you believe in what you're doing and you believe that the result is not compromised, then the financial parts of it, in terms of how successful the film is, aren't that important. I'm speaking from the perspective of an artist. I mean, obviously, from the studio perspective, they're a lot less happy about that if the film doesn't make money.
Yeah. You know, the other thing I feel about cinema and filmmaking is what I'm looking for, and this is especially as an actor, is when I get offered a film and you know, I meet the director, what I'm really looking for is, does he have a story to tell? And I'll tell you what I mean by that. So if we're sitting in a party, the 20 of us, and I ask you to tell us something interesting that's happened in your life, so you would think about it and then think of something and then tell me that, oh yeah, well, once this happened and that happened. Now the same situation, there's a party going on, 20 people, the bell rings, you walk in and you say, guys, you won't believe what happened. Shut the music off. Listen to me, guys. Listen. You will grab everyone. You have a story to tell. You will grab everyone's attention, and you'll make sure they listen to you. And there'll be an energy in the way that you're telling that same story. And so that's what I'm looking for as an actor in a filmmaker.
Yeah.
So does the filmmaker have a story to tell? Is he excited? Has he got something in his stomach that he really wants to come out with? And that's what I felt when Ashutosh came to me with Lagan, or Farhan came to me with, Dil Chahta Hai, or Mehra came to me with Rang De Basanti, many such examples. I think that is one of the key things, because at the end of the day, it's storytelling. So if you're excited, you'll find the right way to tell it.
Yeah.
And if you have a story to tell and you're excited, you will make sure people listen to you. And that's the one center thing I'm looking for always.
I mean, you have to, because I've been fortunate, especially in my last couple of films. But I've made films that haven't made money, films that have bombed. They're just as hard to make. But why do we go through all this? Why do we go through all this long, arduous months of work? Because we believe in the story that we're trying to tell, and you always have to believe in it. You have to be passionate. Do your best. I don't know any filmmaker. I don't know any filmmaker that phones it in. Do you? I mean, there are filmmakers that are better than other filmmakers, but I don't know anybody that's lazy about the task. I think they all work pretty hard.
Yeah.
Some can stare at it forever and miss the important thing. That's true. I mean, you do see people that are limited perceptually.
Yeah.
But they all work hard. Nobody tries to make a bad movie.
Yeah. No, it's a tough job. It really is a tough job and extremely demanding, which is why at the end of it, when a film doesn't work, no matter whose film it is, it's quite heartbreaking.
Yeah.
Because the team has really worked hard on it. Yeah. Yeah.
And there's no secret formula, because you don't know which...
There is never...
What makes a movie fail.
Yeah. Or what makes it succeed. And in fact, I read this thing by Ilya Kazan once. He was speaking about cinema at a gathering, and he was telling them how... what he felt about scripts and what are good films and what are the good, what to look out in a film, etc. And at the end of it, he said, after you've listened to me, you might think that I know all about filmmaking and cinema. How come I still make duds? And he said that's the charm of it.
Yeah.
I like the way he put it. He said that's the charm of it. That you know it all, but sometimes you still miss things and it happens.
Yeah. But I think we're still learning. I mean, you were talking about coming to LA and learning some of the stuff that we were doing. I like to go to visit other filmmakers and see how they work, and I always get inspired. Like Robert Rodriguez, I went to visit him. He had his editing room set up in his living room. He'd moved all the furniture out and set up his editing suite there. It was just total passion. He was cutting his own film. He cut it himself. He shot it himself. He scored it himself. Mm-hmm. I thought, wow, that's great. This guy's a genius. I couldn't do all that stuff. Mm. Although I do like to edit myself, but I got the bug to edit from watching him.
Right.
I just think you have to stay humble before the craft. There's always something new to learn.
Mm.
And sometimes I even take it farther, which is I'm going to put myself in a place where I don't know the answer. Mm. By design, I don't want to be the guy that knows everything. I want to be finding out something new. Maybe make a film on a subject that I don't know, because I'll learn about it. If it's something I've always been amazed by or curious about.
Yeah, yeah. The other thing I was thinking about where the future is headed for cinema, and I don't know whether this makes any sense at all, but I think that, up until recently, cinema was, for a privileged few, in the sense that you had to go through the grind, you had to make your way through film school or be an assistant and work your way up, and until after working for 5, maybe 10 years, you finally get the chance to make a film. So you're on a set and you have a camera and you have actors and you're making a film. I think with digital cameras coming by, with cell phones having cameras on them, with softwares, editing softwares and sound softwares, with the internet now, I think filmmaking or storytelling and using film to tell a story. I'm using the word film loosely, but using images and sound to tell a story is now not just the prerogative of just a few of us. I think each one has a story to tell today. And each one can, in that sense, tell that story
right.
in his or own way. So I think the future, we need to look at that as a possible, you know, I don't know, as a future as well for I don't know what the future holds in that area of
saying it's not a closed club anymore.
It's not a closed club anymore. I mean,
no,
you know, my kid can just pick up a camera and make a film. Vinod was telling me his daughter was shooting him today and she shot him upside down and said, you know, everyone looks like they're walking on the ceiling and stuff. Now, you know, that's a kid of 8 years old. And so I'm saying each one of us is now empowered in a certain sense to be able to tell a story and to use the world of the internet to actually exhibit the film. You know, that's a strong possibility, and it'll happen more and more as we go along.
And you don't need to go up through a hierarchy to become a director. You can just become a director right away. You just get some friends together, get some friends together and make a film.
Yeah.
And then you can go on Final Cut Pro on your laptop, and you can edit it, and you can make a complete thing, and then you just do a little character font to say, directed by.
Yeah.
And once your name's on there as a director,
that's it.
You're a director. You know, whereas before you used to have to come in through music videos or maybe through Roger Corman.
It's a long
budget
story.
Film.
It's a long story.
And a lot of those avenues of entry don't exist anymore.
Mm.
You know, because that super low budget market doesn't exist other than for kind of quality independent films, but the kind of schlock low budget market doesn't exist anymore.
Yeah.
It's been kind of wiped out by cable. So now this kind of, you know, democratic access to the tools of the trade is the way to compensate for that. And people can come to you with an amazing short film that they've made for not very much money that has pretty professional quality, you know, production values. I think that's a really interesting point.
And you know, I think it'll get more personalized. You know, storytelling will get more personalized in that manner. I mean, it is, as we speak, it is getting more personalized. You know, I know of a number of people who are making these short films, and they're not filmmakers as we understand them. But they are making films.
Well, there was a big hit film last year in the U.S. I think actually internationally as well, called Paranormal Activity.
That's right.
It cost $20,000 to make.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, I don't even know how you do. I don't even know how you feed the crew for a day. You know, but. But it probably cost 50 times that amount to publicize it, to release it.
Right.
You know? They made this film for like $20,000. It's incredible. I mean, the production values aren't very good, but they don't need to be because they actually incorporated that kind of amateur camera look into the form, into the style of the film, into the form of the film. Mm-hmm. So it worked. You know, and there have been other examples of that as well, like Blair Witch Project, which was a very successful film. Was made for almost no money. So yeah, I mean, there is no barrier to entry now. I think you're absolutely right on that.
Well, you're seeing the trends. That means low budget. On the other hand, your high budget one, where you're looking at 3D, digital theaters, and so forth. So you've got the complete gamut in a way.
See, that's what I love about cinema. Is there's room for
there's no restriction.
Room for that whole spectrum. There's room for that. You know, I mean, we couldn't have done the types of things we were doing on Avatar on a lower budget. We could have told some version of that story, but we couldn't have done those images. Mm. People ask me, all right, what's the next thing? What do you want to do next? What's the next new cool thing? I say, I want to be able to do the same type of thing as Avatar for half the money and in half the time. And bring the cost down by improving the process. Because again, it was experimental and we made a lot of mistakes, so we should be able to do it.
But do you think 3D would be only for certain kinds of film?
No, I'm glad you asked that question, because I've been thinking about this a lot. When widescreen first came out, the CinemaScope aspect ratio, it was a way for studios to make their movies seem even bigger.
Mm.
And it was just for a few films a year.
Mm.
And then what happened was the independent community said, oh, I like that aspect ratio. I can compose a story with two people talking in a love story, you know, just on a street, but it'll look great. It'll look like a big movie, or aesthetically, we'll just like that composition, you know? So very quickly, a tool of mega movies was adopted by independent cinema. And I believe that a drama would strongly benefit from being shot in 3D because of that sense of being physically present, you know? Because, I mean, what do we try to do in film? We try to put the audience
as real
inside.
As possible,
you know, why do we cut to an over-the-shoulder shot where we see a bit of the person in the foreground? Because it's a way of being that person. You become that person for a moment. Mm. And then in a very dreamlike way, we go to the opposite side and we become that person for a moment. Mm-hmm. So in a way, you know, the filmmaking process is a kind of avatar process. They are our avatars while we're watching it. They become a version of us. We project our emotions into the people mm-hmm. on the screens. Well, 3D heightens that experience.
Yes.
So, you know, and I would say that the additional cost of shooting in 3D is not so great if you're doing a strictly live action film. It gets more when you're starting to mix effects into it. It gets more complicated compositing the images. And if you're doing a pure CG film, it's not much additional cost. You're kind of a bell curve. It's more expensive in the middle where it's a mixture of the two, mm-hmm. which is of course where Avatar was. But if you're doing a straight dramatic film, you can do it quite inexpensively in 3D. Mm-hmm. And nobody's done this yet, but.
Mm-hmm. So we can expect a flood of 3D films now from Hollywood?
I'm concerned about a flood of bad 3D.
Okay.
Yeah, because that will really turn it off.
Yeah, exactly. So we need to make sure the quality stays high. And, you know, I personally, as a filmmaker, I would share anything that I've learned with any other filmmaker to prevent them from making the same mistakes I had made. It's like, sure. They'll make their own mistakes. Just don't make the same mistakes
ones,
we
yeah.
made. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So 3D film for you?
I mean, I would love to. And I'm serious, James. I'd like to come there and you know, just watch how you've made Avatar, you know. Watch how you shot it, yep. You know, if you can show me the stuff that...
Sure. Well, I'm unemployed, so now's a good time.
Good. Okay, I'm going to open it up to the floor to see what questions they'd like to ask. I want to thank the two great movie makers. You're a witness to almost pillow talk here of two great movie makers.